chapter 9 of Sitar ED is good. Mirrored to the blind. I'm at the service station getting my car fixed up as I read out chapter 9 to you. So I've read 212 pages so far, and I'm elated that I did read them. And I'm glad that Tamina Durrani, the writer of My Great Lord, which I think is a bigger achievement to her than being at any point in time chief minister or any prime minister's wife. That I don't think is a valid enough or respectable title is My Great Lord, an amazing book she wrote, exposing the abuses of men against women, feudal men, and I would say in general men against women in Islamic or other societies. Right, so chapter 9. Our life had only a few moments away from grief. Our life had only a few moments away from grief in 1986 when the Philippine government awarded us the prestigious Magsaysay Award. I had not thought it important to receive it personally. Explained to my wife, the more work we do, the more awards will be presented to us. Soon we'll get caught up with this new occupation. But Keith argued against my opinion. Why are you always looking at the negative side of appreciation? A Pakistani has been recognized as a good human being. You cannot refuse to project that. It is not about you. I remained suspicious of her national inclination towards outings and was adamant not to agree until I myself became convinced. We packed two pairs of clothes each. I wore my rubber slippers and carried my canvas bag while Bilkis clutched her plastic basket that, despite everybody's prayers to replace it with a decent handbag, she refused. I'll go with what I can with what I always carry. My husband never changes his appearance for the exam for other people. In the Philippines, two government officials received us at the immigration counter. Passport stamped, they ushered us out towards a band heralding our arrival, and a group of Filipinos hung flower garlands around our necks. He drove off in a limousine to a five-star hotel. Alone in the room, Bilkis exclaimed, "Look at the respect foreigners have given you. Pakistan should give you this respect more than them." The reception at the airport had forewarned me of my wife's recurring glee on many occasions during this trip. When her eyes fell on the bed, she fell on it. "I never imagined a bed could be this soft. Come and try it. You'll believe me only when you sit on it." She removed the coverlet and became enthralled by the snow-white sheets. Smelled them, buried her nose in a pillow and swooned. They smell of roses. Do they have perfumed water here? Such big sheets must need drums of water to wash. It can't be flowing in taps. She lay down and rolled around the mattress. Why does it spring? Is it the mattress or the base? I marveled at her excitement, just as much as she did at the bed, and said to her, "Please, after all you've seen in the world, why do you still love this bed as much, so much? How can it keep your interest?" She was too absorbed in observing everything inside, and shifted from one chair to another, opened drawers, pierced into lampshades, and looked out the windows. When she felt the curtains, she exclaimed, "Look how thick the fabric is." "No, it's not the fabric. It's layers of cloth stitched together." She stole to the refrigerator, opened it, stared at it, and went, "Alcohol, so many bottles of alcohol and so many chocolates." Handing me a slap, she sarcastically reminded me of my encounter with the Turkish girl and walked off towards the bathroom. When she opened the door, she gasped, "You have to see this. You've never seen anything like it." She disappeared from sight and shouted, "Look at the taps. Just come and look. Even the floor is like a mirror. I swear I can see my face in it. Come and see." Bilkis emerged and responded to my expression. "We are not taking anything home. I'm just looking for new stories. I'll tell everyone about what I saw. Left to you. All I would speak of to the deprived is tales that they have experienced themselves." I laughed. "You always pacified me by somehow linking everything to my work." I stretched out on the carpet to sleep. Bilkis would not let me. In fact, she tried everything in her power to make me shift to the piece of furniture that so fascinated her. But nothing worked on me that day, and I told her to let me be. Finally, she gave up and slept soundly on the bed while I grounded myself on the floor. Next morning, she demanded, "Save money and buy me a bed like this one. I've never slept better." I pretended not to have heard and hoped she would not repeat herself. Bilkis knew very well that enthusiasm for things that I abhorred worked well in catching my attention, and I knew very well that she had never let me down. We washed our clothes in the bath and hung them on the towel rails to dry. And a Pakistani attendant informed us that a laundry service was available. Bilkis laughed with him. We originated from a washerman's village called Dhobi Bada in Bantwa. We are experts in the laundry business and love washing clothes. The afternoon and every day thereafter was accompanied. We accompanied a lady for rehearsal to a grand hall where the award ceremony would take place. Standing in line with doctors, professors, and social workers representing six different nations, for we moved behind a curtain to await our turn to be called out and emerged to stand at attention before our respective national flags, while musicians played the national anthem of each country. By the end of the anthem, the award winner was to walk up to the race dais. Returning to the hotel for me was as excited to be pleased as everything else that was happening to us. She'd be longing for rehearsals to end so that she could please rise more than her stomach on the buffet table. It was another novelty. What colorful food. Look at the food. What food is this? I've never seen it before. So many desserts. Then she noticed something more unusual than all this and cried out, look at the tomato flower. How did this twirl the reddish? Are they carved with a knife? Silkies would sit gazing at plates heaped with decorative vegetables, studying them carefully and devouring them even more carefully. She asked me sweetly, please can I take some home? The girls can learn to make them. I refused to let them. We took the guns route and the final ceremony commenced with the Philippines national anthem. When our names were announced, we emerged from behind the curtain to take a position in front of Pakistan's green and white flag. The band played our national anthem and our eyes filled with tears. Silkies and I walked up to the stage together, where we were presented the gold medal along with $20,000. I delivered my speech in Urdu with Hindi better. Illiteracy had never inhibited me from speaking full learned men. I told them my concept of collective social welfare and it truly was my vision as an ordinary citizen to transform Pakistan into a modern welfare state, a model for the third world to adopt. As Bilkis and I walked down, we received a standing ovation. The next day, we attended a reception hosted by Prime Minister Kori Aquino at the palace. Bilkis was aghast at the splendor of chandeliers hanging from high ceilings in this building. They seemed to hang from the sky. She noted everything, turning to me for attention every time she saw something that fascinated her, and everything did. I was amused that although she knew my reactions, she would not give up her efforts to share hers with me. The Prime Minister looked as surprised at us as Bilkis did with her home. She stared repeatedly and obviously at in our direction before we finally introduced. Bilkis must have looked strange with her plastic basket, and I, as much as I am incongruous in this splendid setting, everything was incongruous to a man representing the world's majority. On our way home, we stopped in Thailand on the king's invitation and attended the banquet similar to the one in the Philippines. We then flew to Bangladesh, where the lush green foliage could not conceal its poverty. Our center remained involved throughout the year, coping with the harrowing consequences of floods, famine, and drought. Burial services and two ambulances operated on the same pattern as in Pakistan. While I constantly checking operations, Bilkis accompanied me, relishing the popular dry fish of rainy season that she carried on a newspaper. See, this is a service station. So, poor man service station. Yeah, that's where I wash my car. I mean, there are more. This is half the price of the other service stations. And that's where I'm reading it out. Next to me is a Bengali guy speaking in Bengali. Might upset somebody, but sorry, that's what it is. And I mean, I steal time to read this whenever I can. On my return to Pakistan, I immediately resumed work. As always, too much time was lost by my absence and pending matters drove me with a maddening energy. Bilkis, meanwhile, excitedly related her experiences to the women at the centers. And over the weeks, her story circulated and were transformed to exaggeration into completely new ones. The same year, I was awarded the USSR Peace Prize for our services during the Armenian earthquake. Kubra and Altaf were blessed with their first son, whom they named Kasher. Bilkis now informed me. After the grocery store shuts, Altaf feeds shellfish at a seafood restaurant. I became suspicious of the situation. Bilkis specified me. When he returns, Kubra bathes his hands in warm water to ease the pain. She's a good wife. Instinctively, I was uneasy and felt that the young couple remained incompatible. I told Bilkis, Kubra is not looking for wealth. That was a childish phase. She's now looking for purpose. Altaf will have to raise his value for life to gain her respect. Perhaps she's looking for me. My wife was no longer perturbed and the worry dissipated only because I chose to ignore what was not in my control. NGOs that had cropped up all over Pakistan during General Zia's regime approached me for some reason or the other. I did not wish to belong to the chamber of charitable organization that ran at the upper level, where office space cost exorbitant sums of money and the staff were upwardly mobile, where leaders traveled first class, stayed in five-star hotels, and salaries increased as standards of living consistently improved. Behind these noble causes, I always detected self-elevation and pointed out whoever suggested that I join up. Luxury and commitment to welfare cannot coexist. The merging of the two is impossible without one affecting the other. It is impossible for the commitment for the committed to live two lives. Those who have not awakened to the fallible nature of man are innocently or ignorantly exposed to strong corrupting forces. They are surely not secure from influence. My own survival in this field was only because of constant alertness to this lurking usurper. It destination I had marked out had drawn closer only by realization of this truth against all diversions from it. Despite conscious shielding, I still felt the strength of these forces against my own frugal nature, austere living, and strong commitment. I was not safe in my meter the rock as my children were at risk in Rabia Ma's simple home. Kubra presents an apt example. Then, how are these people swamped in luxury, protected from it? Are they different from me? Are they infallible? When I disclosed the insight to an eminent social worker, he seemed convinced, but never returned to my office. Without adopting the ideology of social welfare, without the highest level of commitment to it, so that it became a way of life, it was merely a side business, a show business, a hobby or a profession, not a mission. How could I now propound the methods I had rejected despite dangerous opposition in my youth? What was the difference here? I told many activists, unless a social worker or a political leader hears the majority's heart throbbing in his own, he cannot know the diversity of their problems. Only when you cut your own finger do you feel an accurate pain. People were running a race in all sections of society, moving one way towards themselves, and social workers were no different. They returned to the comfort of decorated houses, took long holidays in different countries, and purchased every consumer good that eased labor. Then how can they endure the fatigue and drill of a dehumanized environment? They make a short visit, hold long meetings in air-conditioned offices, make 100 plans, and employ others to deal with the mess. What awareness do they propound when they have not themselves adopted or even considered the basic concept of self-help? I always warned volunteers against them. The intrigues of the lazy stalk everywhere. They play with money to entice you away. Working from the midst of common offers, from the midst of comfort, offers an inferior substandard commitment. It's not reliable. In fact, it is suspect. Their purpose was usually my own help. I would say it whenever they came to me armed with briefcases bulging with documents, photographs, press clippings, and company constitutions. To me, the paraphernalia represented air-conditioned offices, leather chairs, powerful presidents, and some charity work. It was a subject that I had ample knowledge of. When self-aggrandizement motivated this vocation, it was transparent to me. So when people come up with foundations or whatever, you know, NGOs, welfare organizations, their names, probably that's what they're looking at, to be recognized, cheered, and respected as human rights activists or social workers was the passion of some. Like wealth and power was a passion for others. Politicians, for example. I told him often, as flattery is a highly potent and addictive drug, applause, fame, and success are not necessarily achieved by genuine motives and selfless intentions. I was not against their work, and in-depth research of people's problems and a lifetime of practical experience had, however, made me wary of them. Small work is good, but it cannot solve anything. You have to think in terms of wholesale for me to be interested. That's what I think as well. Think big wholesale. I would hear their plans revolve around some posh area of a big city and shake my head. As people have no means to travel, they cannot reach the building you construct. Or will you provide nationwide transport? I advise them. Reach the people, take your services into the hinterland to those who have no access to cities. It was my consistent plea to social organizations to not waste time and money on limited operations. People like basic amenities close at hand. I had also told many activists, until human rights are confined to drawing rooms, basic rights will not be provided. What is this long list of other rights you're trying to secure? The right to live is a core issue concerning mankind across the universe, looking towards the wide implications that might bring forth some results. Until the majority is not your circle, 95% are not your subject. If you want to change state politics and intelligence towards a welfare system now, then you'll be talking of human rights. To an eminent social activist who showed me a long list of revolt cases, I said, small work cannot resolve anything. They are distractions and diversions from the core problem. This is not success. The advantage of a collective movement is before you in the form of ambulances which reach within minutes without favor or discrimination. But a mercenary social worker trade is wounded when emergency facilities are available at a grassroots level. The wireless system I aim to provide to every 100 villages would bring a society under control, and every village would be connected to us by a communication system, and medical facilities would become available at every 25 kilometers. Roads would also be improved. I had begun recruiting boys from college and universities for that task. Many educationalists would hear these ideas. If there was no illiteracy, there would also be no need for us. We gave first aid as a general priority so that society became conscious of our white concept. When I began working, people laughed. Now we are recruiting volunteers. Many teachers who taught as a profession were prepared to join our platform to teach people to read and write. We will soon spread a system of projects at distances of 25, 50, and 100 kilometers. I was always advising them, highlighting one person's pain cannot change anything. We know the issue. We have dealt with millions of cases. Instead of spending energy and drawing attention to one, give us a solution to correct it on a mass scale. Like a doctor, I'm immune to an individual's pain. Diagnosis and treatment is my job, not failing and trying. Non-supported NGOs, very few, small and ineffective. Wherever there was a true ideology, it became a liability. And where there was honesty of purpose, there was also no support. What would we gain by it was the common attitude of potential patrons. These genuine organizations were in doldrums. Inadequate funds could do only small work, and lack of purity and faith in the environmental solution, many good people out of the field, many of them supported the ED Foundation. Whereas small charities with big patrons were common, the lower middle class, the scooter level, contributed to me. I would blast out at the public and I heard them donating stupidly. Nobody tells me to increase and expand the network. Nobody offers me a hand and say, go ahead, we'll be with you. They tell me to work less and explain, there's already too much in your hands, ED Sahib. Agents, prominent social workers, would spread rumors by word of mouth. ED is an agent of Jews and Hindus. That is why he cannot discriminate. The poor absorb the propaganda. Then confused Maulvis got hold of the rumors, and the poor walked shoulder to shoulder with them, spreading the lies. So and so said this about ED. Have you heard? All over the mohalla, just the neighborhood, and out across the country, the story would distort and take on many forms. Always based on hearsay, some activists would say to people, why should you help ED when he is for free anyways? I would shout when I heard this. If the foundation drowned during my lifetime, these people would come up with the most common expression, God is our helper. And revert to carrying bodies on donkey carts. According to my assessment, the entire population of the country, including myself, was suffering from at least 2% neurosis, if not more. There were many hostile instances, mostly instigated by the social work sector. At a meeting, a big industrialist stood up and shouted, ED has opened a bank and industry. People shooed him away and out of the door. And at another function, a big state said, ED has no right to work alone. An experienced industrialist should be his boss. Agents clapped like pimps to flatter their bosses, shouting, the state should be president. I laughed with my friends at that possibility. He'll eat up everything and never come to work. The weak-minded always give certificates to robbers. I'd always stress that if a mosque had an Amir, it would not require a committee. Maulvis have also become enslaved. They cannot raise a voice on any relevant matter, as the committee does not allow him to break fast. Every good man is kicked out in the group's interest. I would say to many religious leaders, open your mosque and introduce a Bait ul Mal, a dispensary, a widow's protection center, an ambulance point, a hospital, and a school. From its vicinity, dispense justice without discrimination. Where there are more Christians, build a church. The philosophy on religion was a much discussed subject, but its practice was nil. It was the same case all over the world and with all religions. No one stopped for another. No one went out of their way. There were no feelings, not one tear. Even at funerals, families gathered as if for a social event. Everybody cried only for themselves. I am a witness to one such event in Karachi when a writer died. The writer and a big bureaucrat, I will not name him because his son is a friend. The sir arranged for his post-burial meeting, whatever. And there was dinner catered to from a five-star. So everybody was busy in small talk and backbiting, etc. When I became troubled by the environment, I would warn everyone. If I stop work, there will be an international pressure on the government to perform. As there is too much work for busy leaders and lazy administration, they would find it difficult to lose my services. I would sometimes be appalled at my position. I am a NEET with an average attendance of 2 days a week from 10 in the morning to 2 in the afternoon. Officials make a perfunctory visit to their workplace in a smooth air-conditioned car. They recline in the luxury of government grants, as well as spend the department's tiny budget gobbling up the average 10 rupee per head grant for the cook, the peon, and the tea. What will they do without me? Nehru Foundation was free. It was open. 100 crates of mangoes and seasonal fruits were distributed in jails and amongst destitutes every 15 days. I would tell social workers to talk of humanitarianism. As the subject has a sentimental reputation, no one talks of it. Make politicians aware that it is the only political solution. That I'd held on was beyond my own understanding. Today, I could put it down to my stubborn nature, constant distractions and obstacles. Too much work, too little money, and no appreciation made me adopt a pace that made everyone move fast towards this goal. Truck drivers, laborers, bus, taxi, and rickshaw drivers, poor girls and boys from universities supported me. They knew that the welfare of all people lay here. I would tell my friends, why does the laborer, the farmer, the dacoit, and the taxi driver respect me? Only because my indiscriminatory work articulates their inner voice and my life interprets a language they feel they do not know how to adopt yet. The educated class that was neutral and unbiased had also begun to support us. The truthful, unbiased thinker and liberal progressive has a mind that draws comparisons. His intellect searches and discovers practical evidence beneath the noise of false propaganda. Sometimes a home truth would explode in my face. As there was no photograph available, finding a lost child was a major problem. I would always be furious at this. How do you know about cigarettes and not about photographs? How do you spend on the latter and not on the former? We would have to look for a faceless person, one who looked like everybody else. When I received permission from the government to telecast an appeal for information on the whereabouts of a mute child, I personally handed over the confirmation letter at the television station. In the same office, I met a prominent social worker. The evening, we switched on the box and waited for the advertisement, but it was not telecast. I was furious for two reasons. As I had never expected the government to agree with my dream, and so also I had never sought its favor to ease the burden on my shoulders. In this case, I had requested help. They had given approval, and it became my right to demand its implementation. My approval finally succeeded, and the appeal was relayed, within half an hour of which the lost child was delivered to our center. Then the social worker I had met at the station appeared and insisted that as the girl was also registered with this organization, she should be handed over to him. I understood the delay in the telecast and was embarrassed at the level of competition. It was not my habit to move back with pressure, and so I surged forward to claim the child. I explained the reaction to my colleagues. It has taken nearly four decades for us to establish an efficient, reliable system whereby most people feel assured we can best locate a lost person. If you have not already done so, the public knows why, how, and where to approach us. If I allow the silly games of competitors to play on this fragile ray of hope, if I allow them to disturb the growing awareness to us, people will become confused. We will become entangled with those who wish to raise the number of their cases like points of victory. I had extended a hand of trust, provided a sympathetic shelter without discrimination or favor. It had triggered off a slow and steady step-by-step awareness to humanitarianism. Having done that, it was dangerous to allow anybody less committed, especially fluent social workers, to make it fertile breeding ground for fame, money, and applause. That was not its purpose. By the greed for advantages, we can lose decades of hard labor and be sent back to start. I told my friends, if social workers are in competition, we're out of it. Only those who come into our circle of collective work will get our attention. There should be no problems if our goals are mutual. I developed an extensive program for the mentally disturbed, having studied with great concern why those who were not congenially ill were stricken by this demon. I concluded that behind the wreckage of disturbed minds was more confirmation of social and state injustice. Personality disorders and family reactions were both rooted in the same source. Children commonly lost their mental faculties in forceps delivery cases, high uncontrolled fever, or when at the earliest rebellion and slightest folly, parents physically abused and mothers ignorantly hit their children on their heads with wooden rolling pins. Sadly, normal people neither had the vision nor any idea of how to deal with the consequences. Parents commanded the disturbed child, expecting logic and reason to prevail. is, they might as well be reprimanding a dog or a cat, constantly referring to them as lying scoundrels and terming their abnormalities as dramas. They push the child off the brink of sanity in rural areas that were tied with ropes and retained at home. Left to loiter, they ate wet mud. Many curable patients were destroyed by reactions towards an ailment neither party understood. Outside the community mocked and taunted the mentally disturbed, abusing and beating them, so that both the security of home and the environment outside became a torment. I explained to a group of boys who teased me, but who teased a psychotic, these unfortunate people are corpses living out their prescribed time. The trauma of managing one psychotic member destroyed the entire household, and the absence of state support introduced desperate measures which they were forced to resort to. Autism is one case now, I'm speaking as Imran. The official procedure for admittance to an asylum was so entangled in red tape that the poor, already struggling against severe hardship, had no option but to save themselves by abandoning their disturbed brethren in some holy shrine without any trace of an address. Senile mothers of many millionaires' sons were torn from their homes and dumped at our doorstep. She spoils the drawing room, drops her food on the carpet, makes a mess everywhere, and listens to nobody. It was how some sons described the burden of which even the facility of wealth could not carry. As owning up to them was an embarrassment, they hardly ever returned to check or visit again. Families who never bothered to inquire about the relative's condition for years had initially requested, "Edi Sahib, in case of an emergency, please let us know. We will be worried." Although we had returned many bodies, I was always loath to do so and complained to Bilkis. They declared them dead when they were alive, walking away without responsibility. Why should they mourn them now? Bilkis rightly assessed, so that people can dole, sympathize, and praise them for being devoted children. When the story behind the funeral was this gruesome, I hated to participate in the encouragement of hypocrisy, hated to exonerate them. And we mostly made burial arrangements ourselves. The family was informed whenever it turned up, which was very sad. A few mothers visited their young daughters, but they were left unsettled after the visit. I explained the problems. We make her forget, and you make her remember. Months of separation and pain follow, until finally you both forget and readjust. Then you suddenly reappear. What is this game? I will cure her temperament, and you take her back, take her home. For that, they were not ready, nor were they prepared to make regular visits. Our strict rules put you to these disturbances. Visited their young daughters, but they were left unsettled after the visit. I explained the problems. Anyway, the hue and cry my opponents raised about the lack of care these people received in my institution had always irritated me. Criticism became more ridiculous when they added, "He picks up corrupt women and non-Muslim psychotics on footpath. He collects them for some unknown purpose." I shouted at the journalist who inquired the purpose. "I do not have time to indulge in explaining my purpose. If you need to know, use your mind, make an effort and find it out yourself." People love to go around in circles. When they found an answer, they hated to accept it and make another circle. I told the newsman, "Mentally disturbed women are incapable of corruption. They're not even aware that they exist. Normal men, however, cannot resist raping them. They coax us senseless out of the sanctity of shrines and disrupt their search for food from garbage dumps. They're greedy, even for the likes of them. After using them, they have the audacity to brand them with an allegation. Is this not a common problem women in closed societies face? Is she not always the bearer of the stain, even when she's insane? A man just crushes himself clean. Many psychotic girls came to us pregnant. Men love reconciled to lice, stench, and lunacy for a few moments of pleasure, rather than becoming reconciled to self-control." The reference to non-Muslims infuriated me even more. I challenged the man, "Which religion forbids you to feed and clothe them? Who is religion supposed to benefit if not people in dire need? Nowhere am I told to bypass a non-Muslim in stress. Nowhere am I instructed to focus compassion solely on the followers of Islam. Or should I follow instructions from you? This attitude is a horrific distortion." I asked the reporter, who seemed to believe in the distortion himself, "Are you insisting that he is not God of the universe and must be restricted to a few? That proclamation is in fact deserving of a fatwa." Psychotics at the civil and Jinnah hospitals for the treatment of body sores. They had turned us away. That there was neither any treatment, nor cure, nor hospital, nor living space for them prompted me to build a place of permanent protection. As their numbers rose far beyond the space our buffer zone center provided, I purchased 65 acres of land adjacent to Karachi's main highway, called the Dili Village, and shifted male patients there. the buffer zone center became an exclusive sanctuary for women. To care for the mentally disabled was both the most difficult and most fulfilling endeavor I had ever undertaken. People unable to reason were also unable to wash themselves. In fact, they refused the use of lavatories and made a mess everywhere. Women shunned protection during their monthly period, and to maintain any standard of hygiene was a monumental task. Itching caused sores, which needed regular cleansing. Injections prescribed by doctors had proved ineffective, as had many other methods we had tried. When all else failed, I returned to my old treatment of the sulfur and camphor solutions. It was the only one that worked. In the past, I had bathed 40 to 50 persons at a time on the roof. Now, every Friday, after morning prayers, I drove down the main highway to Edi village. This routine became a priority for which I tried to return no matter where I was. No other program was more important. Before my arrival, hundreds of boys were gathered in a large fenced area in the center of which was a circular tank containing the solution. The boys would spot my ambulance rolling down the long driveway, and an explosive welcome reached me long before I reached them. Maulana Abu has come, Maulana Abu has come. That those who were aware of nothing were aware of me was a joy that equaled no other. Sometimes when entering the fenced area, one of the boys would kiss my cheek. Then each one demanded to display the same form of affection, clamoring and pushing each other to reach me. As I could not refuse one and accept another, everything would be out of control. Their runny noses, frothing mouths, and dangerous temperaments never separated us. I marveled at their sensitivity towards a man who truly loved them. Rolling up my pajamas, followed by excited naked boys, I would walk to the well and sit on its 2-foot boundary wall. Turn by turn, they crouched before me on their haunches, and I dipped the jug into the water, raised it high above their heads, and poured it amongst peals of laughter. While they played and tried to gulp down the cleansing solution before it trickled down their bodies, I repeated the procedure 5 or 6 times, performing the highest form of prayer. This was my Hajj. The boys would scramble up to the roof to dry off in fresh air. When they were all gone, I would offer my afternoon prayers. Sometimes I was questioned, either side, the boys were unclean and your clothes were wet with dirty water, yet you pray. I would always give the same reply. They're a cleaner way of evolution. Neither were obligatory prayers a diversion from work. They were not meant to be. My concern was solely with the surrender to God. How, what, and when were secondary matters. I spared myself time by saying the prayer in its shortest form, whereas sometimes I prayed for a long time. I'd always directed my friends towards the same way. There's no confining restrictions in my worship of the Almighty. It's humble and simple. The 5-time rituals is a 5-time reminder to adopt a new way of life. In fact, it's a reminder to pray. And prayer is a way of life. Struggle is the power of prayer. It is its motivator, its spirit, and its demand. The confused, on the other hand, wanted to lengthen the ritual and shorten the prayer. I'd also advise my children, life demands the surrender of man in spirit, because therein lies his true freedom. Rituals without practice are fetters. My mother prayed all her life by reciting only Bismillah. Was her humility and surrender unacceptable? Nothing would make me believe that. I had pondered long over how I might be able to instill the doctrine of intention in prayer. The boys would dress and join me for lunch on the floor in long parallel lines. I never rebuked them for the way they ate. I was happy that they did so at all. Like cancer in its 3rd or 4th stage, the cure of this disease is always very rare, and an improved quality of life is the only treatment. I had seen the conditions of mental hospitals in the US and Europe, where patients were confined without fresh air or sunshine, and the smell of closed chambers was nauseating. A staff of 25 people was employed to manage 50 patients. At Edi village, the walls were tiled to maintain cleanliness, and its architecture provided for a maximum airflow. Large open spaces surrounding the building where patients could roam freely. The mentally ill needed open space and food. Nothing was equal to these two facilities. At a meeting of supervisors, I explained my concept. Psychotics are used to roaming freely on the roads. They like to drift on and on endlessly. Given that, they do not need too much supervision. They hate rooms and confinement. When I made a 500-foot ward in Edi village and a huge one at the buffer zone, they jumped to take permanent possession of the space and settle down. Then they fought with their neighbors and built friendships and enmities just as if it were a mohalla or neighborhood. Buildings were constructed with the help of residents and addicts. As was the rule of the organization, even here I had established the methods of self-help, and the relatively stable patients helped those who were worse off. They were encouraged to adopt responsibility as best as they could. Over them was a small team of supervisors. Bill Case organized women's baths on the same lines. As most psychotics spend the whole day outdoors, hating to wear clothes. Extra high walls were built for privacy in female quarters. Bill Keys would sit with them for hours and hours, a pen and ED notebook on her lap, granting make-believe requests to attend visits, attend weddings or visit families. They would lodge complaints against each other. She would pretend to note them down. They would discuss imagined proposals of marriage. I leave the decision to you, Bill Keys. I'll marry only if you agree. Bill Keys would ask 100 questions, where he worked, what was his salary, how many sisters and brothers he had. When she would finally agree to the match, everyone would congratulate the bashful bride. A beautiful woman, disappointed by failure in finding a worthy husband, believed the impossible and drove herself to lunacy. I'm the queen of Saudi Arabia. The king will send for me tomorrow. He awaits me. She sent regular letters to the king through Bill Keys, who read out his replies from blank papers. Another believed she was a film actress and Bill Keys would announce to her he received an award for the best actress in the world. Then everyone clapped and cheered, congratulating and kissing the happy woman. Another woman thought she had children when she had none. But messages and gifts never stopped coming from them. Some regularly asked for money to be forwarded to their families and kept accounts. The children's school fees is due again. Send 500 rupees to my account, Bill Keys would say. What a pressure on you. Why can't you leave it to their father? It's his responsibility. The woman would panic. And a long story for responsibilities would be related to my engrossed wife. One woman carried all her luggage, including her beddings, in her arms. She would not part with it and was always set to travel home. But there was no home. Her entire family had been swept away by a flood. A woman with a child insisted that it was mine. Sometimes she would run away and get raped, then come back with another in her womb saying, "You married me. It was your child I had. I swear by God." There were so many stories. Every day women gave Bill Keys false accounts of where they went last night, who they visited, what they bought. Although both of us had a close friendship with all the inmates, I marveled that she never even forgot their names. Because she could not take psychotic patients for outings, she entertained them in their quarters. With help from the girls in the center, they organized variety shows and dramas, and on Independence Day and Eve, they decorated the halls, dressed up and cut a cake. Award ceremonies were arranged every few months. Bill Keys found amazing reasons for the recipients. An award for stopping a fight to the rowdiest, for the combat with life to the laziest, for cleanliness to the dirtiest, the joy and the excitement created an environment of love and belonging. For me, simply dispelled lethargy. Domestic servants raped by employers, little girls assaulted by guardian and relatives, some by their own fathers, or attacked by groups of men at shrines. Rape and subsequent pregnancy was an issue that lay on the shoulders of a state. What is the alternative of this disorder? Has the issue ever been taken seriously and considered for a solution? Did the state provide these people with any rehabilitation program? There was an audacity in the extent of impunity, and yet they talked of an Islamic law on adultery. These are things that me, Imran Vaiz Kazmi, is astounded at. I'm so glad that we had a person like Edi in our country. Two religious preachers heard me speak at a news forum and wrote to the Mithadar address saying, "From your words, we have understood that you are not a Muslim." I threw the letter away. At a function in Karachi's polo grounds, I addressed businessmen, industrialists, and ministers and criticized the people's understanding of religion. The next day, some men arrived to give my friend a sermon against my views. When they left, my colleague said, "Thank God, the press censors everything he says." When one of my strongest women opponents, a big saint, got blood cancer, he sent for me to his bedside and said, "When a small needle pierces my flesh and I shriek, I understand what you have been advising all these years. I apologize to you." I told him, "The work is God's, not mine. When there is no humanitarianism, there is no work either, as we are out of his circle." Another big name and saint called me and donated 1.25 lakh rupees, saying, "Why do you work so hard for nothing? Do something for yourself with this." I returned his money on the spot. In Karachi's throbbing Buri Bazaar, 3 bombs exploded one after the other in parallel alleys. As no agency was prepared to step into the danger zone, we had rushed from one street to another when an explosion blasted from a third direction. The blast threw people high into the air and they smashed to the ground. Pieces of flesh hung from apartment windows and balconies. A strong smell of burning meat filled the air, and many were maimed or handicapped for life. The bazaar was packed with shoppers who were buried by the time the relatives discovered them missing. Mithadar was flooded with bodies. To avoid the spread of infection, we had to put small pieces into polythene bags and buried them in a mass grave immediately. At these times, shopkeepers abandoned business to escape death, and the moral decadence of society, which had lost both its direction and its spirit, came to the fore. People looted and plundered, some out of necessity, some from temptation, others from ordinary greed. They stole electrical equipment, fabric rolls, carpet, toiletries, spare parts, and food. They carried it away in haste, rushing in and out of shops. It was a strange scene that usually went unnoticed at the time of frenzy, but my eyes were everywhere. That a bomb could explode under us never deterred me. I would jump into the thick of disaster, totally unaware of the consequences, and the whole team, including Bilkis, was quick to follow. A reporter asked me to enlighten him on this fatalistic attitude. I had reached a very common observation. I have confirmation that whereas extreme dangers can pass without death's notice, all safety measures are bypassed when it comes. In the year 1988, which had seemed permanent to the people of Pakistan, was suddenly gone. An army plane exploded in the air with General Zia-ul Haq and his senior associates. Ghulam Asad Khan, the chairman of the Senate, became president and announced a general election. In the November of 1988, the masses mourned Zulfikar Ali Bhutto's death by voting his daughter Benazir Bhutto. During elections, the Washington Post correspondent came at 2 a.m. to meet her for an interview. When I told her that we were a 24-hour service, she dialed our centers to check, and every telephone was attended on the second ring. Only one rang thrice. She was impressed. Even in the U.S., 911 attends a call after 4 or 5 bells. Although democracy was restored, it carried a dangerous spillover from the Afghan war. Martial law had left a legacy of ethnicity, illegal arms, drugs, and 11 years of parleys and pacts with foreign governments centering mainly around the issue of Afghan aid. A self-preserving policy resulted in the neglect and destruction of all institutions and people. I gave my opinion. Either politicians would roll up their sleeves, get down to serious work and create credibility for democracy, for democratic governance, or they'll be overcome with greed and turn away from the massive disorder. If they look for easy and temporary solutions, they'll merely preserve the same ideals and continue with the old legacy until it collapses. It was time for another whitewash, and I pointed it out to those who imagined a better future. We can rejoice until we see the paint peel again. The state of affairs can change only with the highest level of commitment and sacrifice. I did not see any traces of that. Expansion plans were ready. I had taken nearly 15 years to give an implementable shape to Bilkis' suggestion that we spread our services across the country. I was at last in a position to announce to my colleagues, I aim at constructing 500 ED centers at intervals of 25 kilometers on all highways and major length roads. We shall stretch from one end of the country to the other, providing first aid and speedy transfer of accident victims to hospitals as an initial function. We'll provide basic facilities, not only in the health sector, but also to the wayfarer who has no place to sleep or food to eat. Where we cannot build, we will erect tents. They glanced at each other, confirming skepticism in their expression. I continued. In the secondary stage, this project will cover rural and semi-urban areas, provide ambulance services, vaccination, medical facilities, and sanctuaries for destitutes. Eventually, each center will become operative with 3 ambulances, a 4-bed hospital, and a dispensary. All centers will be linked by wireless. I had estimated the cost of each center as well as the nationwide project. Bilkis was successfully running a big nursing school in Karachi. She had made another suggestion. Why do we need more maternity homes? Big buildings require large staff prone to stealing and lethargy. They will run away under the pressure of your rules. Wherever there are 200 or 500 houses in a village, provide maternity care by training women to serve their own areas. I told my colleagues, into the adjoining areas, we will send teams of volunteers to influence young girls and women to apply for courses in nursing and midwifery. Most rural areas were devoid of these facilities and could only be served if people were involved at the grassroots level. Death during childbirth was an unnecessary way to die, and I remembered my wife's words after my accident. Sometimes, through human negligence, you die before your time. I had appealed to the areas Uthal, Thar, and Cholistan to send us women between the ages of 25 to 35 for training. Elaborating on the nationwide project, I told my friends, 25 kilometers is a short distance even when compared to the US, where you reach a hospital after every 10 miles. That by turning off the main highway. Although none of my colleagues discouraged me from this larger than life project, I was sure none could yet comprehend its feasibility. It had long been established that I would only disclose my thoughts to the extent I chose, and nobody inquired more. I had also overcome the apprehensions of the past and was sure as never before that when you take one step in the right direction, God makes it two. Lack of education, influence, power, and finances paled into insignificance.
Life and work had become synonymous long ago. And that means traveling to expand the services became a recreation. Accompanied by three companions, I left Karachi in my ambulance from Bela to Suez, skirting the Durand line into Gilgit and up to the Siachen Glacier. I combed the country and returned from the China border through Sen's vast deserts to Nagar Parga. Driving was spent in silence. The period gave me time to meditate and distance myself from routine administrative work for once more, and once more I returned to the mood that prevailed immediately after my mother's death. Then I had reflected on the basic questions of welfare. Now I studied its long-term significance to world history, realized mistakes, contemplated on new methods, and evaluated and assessed future actions. As I drew further away from home, the area not only grew vast in space, it also stretched in my mind. I no longer moved in distance and time, but over decades and across oceans to far corners of the earth. And these thoughts overwhelmed me. I became tired and was unable to concentrate upon the road. Then I would hand the wheel over to one of my companions and rest my mind rather than my body on the adjacent seat. From one district to another, one village to another, I mingled with people stricken by poverty. Parched faces, tattered clothes, and bodies burned by the sun were splayed across the hinterlands. They believed everything and nothing at the same time. Hardened women sentenced to dual destinies of rigorous labor and childbearing, mud huts and old people both on the verge of crumbling. Thousands and thousands of hungry, barefoot children running amok like predictions of barren futures. Centuries of hopelessness moving nowhere. Back in the ambulance, I thought how strange I must have looked in my colored shirts, how separate and different from the majority of mankind. As I worked, so also I had become. My resemblance to the masses was my salute to them. Adopting the conditions endured by the deprived millions struggling for one mouthful of bread sprung from my belief that their pockets had been picked. My home, my family, and my way of life attempted to remain as low as theirs. Turning away had been impossible. I could not live a life they could not dream. It was now neither intentional nor administrative. It was the only way to live. The seduction of luxury was no longer a temptation. Examples of victims had, however, intensified my abhorrence of it. The stale bread I ate each morning had given me much food for these thoughts. Eating less kept me in touch with pangs of hunger. A full stomach taught nothing. Years went by without the need for new clothes. The old ones served the purpose of covering the body. And what other purpose did they have? Now it was time to sink lower. I'd stepped out and I stepped in. It was a mess, one that I cannot be measured or explained, one that cannot be measured or explained like it is. It was seen and felt. The political environment was sensitive and I was careful not to disturb it. I was treading softly, refraining from reacting at a personal level, careful to talk in general terms, concentrating on building funds to cover the poor. But sirens heralded the cavalcades of the fluent and stretched, polished cars, and the sound tore at my brain. At these times, the administration pushed and shoved people dressed like me aside. Get away, move back, you idiots. Can you not see the areas cordoned off, imbeciles, and the caravans of kings passed by? My heart singed. I would tell my companions, cordon off a street. Why should the public feel pain for that? The whole country is cordoned off for them. The masses have no means or place to live. Why should they need to stand or walk anywhere? It would spread without the noise of slogans for personal support in the garb of public uplift. I became alert to what I was beginning and conscious of my vulnerable and endangered position. Moving from district to district, village to village, always bathing and burying the dead, distracting attention so that my detractors thought I did nothing else, nothing more. A mad social worker crawling in the hopeless mass of illiteracy without any knowledge of the subject they knew not, but held captive. It was important to move silently, even stealthily. If I posed no threat and set no visible example, one day I would succeed. Small Indian booths supplied with medical provision became operative as soon as they were erected, and they were immediately swarming with human traffic from villages. I was cautious of feudal power. If they recognized the development as a corrosion of their influence, especially as the program's aims at the economic development and economic independence of women, they would react. But they could not as yet perceive me, except as an emotional malang who collected arms, served beggars, and buried bodies. I instructed my supporters to refrain from involving political debate. Give no comment or suggestion about political candidates. If you do, we shall be destroyed before we can begin. That's what Edith thought of politicians, by the way. Through urban influence and education, landed youth was undergoing a change. I envisaged that by the time my work became obvious, policies would become more amenable. For now, I remained humble, keeping a low profile until people themselves recognized their own needs. Within 6 months, we were operating in Hyderabad, Sakhar, and Moro. We had purchased land in Multan, Ramyar Khan, Lahore, Faisalabad, Gujranwala, and Peshawar. Remaining away from villages and of the main highways, I supplied an ambulance to each center.
made connections with the closest hospital and provided government hospitals with emergency supplies. The pace of growth was fast as lightning, and yet when I look back, it was so very slow. Foreseeing dangers, I had forestalled my plans. During this development phase, many people volunteered financial help. Some I accepted, some I rejected. Caution and suspicion of indebtedness, influence and interference from individuals, government, and foreign agencies remain in the forefront of my mind. I clarified why the decision would incur no loss to the foundation. Money is not my highest concern. An opportunity to motivate the public will be lost if money arrives in bulk from one source. Lack of the spirit is the major dilemma confronting social uplift. I would prefer to motivate the 12 crore people of Pakistan to give me 1 rupee each per month. That is equivalent to 1 million when weighed in commitment. That is what I've been talking about. As I moved through the interior of Sindh, a delegation from Tata came to me. They tried to convince me to open a center in their area. It is I intended to delay the project until the end of the year. They pleaded and insisted that I personally witness their conditions before deciding, and so I went. Driving before dawn through the vast dry stretches of barren land, I recollected the numerous daybreaks that I had observed. Now I watched again, gazed upwards at the sky, entranced by the symbolic pattern that went unnoticed each morning forever. The night contracted to a solid black before it gradually lifted away. I felt its extreme darkness closing in upon me as we entered the vicinity of Thatta. In the center of the village, a huge lake of stagnant water seemed to have solidified. Small mud houses surrounding the stinking toxic swamp in which millions of mosquitoes spread. As the sun emerged, its burning rays intensified the poisonous fungus and its green color reflected upon the faces of the people. A malarial epidemic plagued them throughout the year. No medical facilities were available. Bundles of flies, fungus creeping in from their corners were set before me. Application to authorities, appeals to parliamentary representatives, ministers, bureaucrats, environmental control bodies, replies, stamps of approval orders, state commands referred to concerned departments, and numerous of the documents covering 6 years still awaited action. I offer the group, I will move here and live with you, provided you learn to clear your own filth and stop depending on the government to resolve your problem. That they looked at me in disbelief was because their minds had not ever thought of self-help. Unfortunately, they represented the bulk of the nation. Apathy had been created and intentionally preserved through decades of slavery, independence, and official imperatives. Now they were bodily crippled, mentally paralyzed, spoiled and confused like children, clutching at old promises. Glaring at the dehumanized symbol of the highest of living creatures, I shouted, "Have you ever stopped to witness an ant carrying its burden, falling down umpteen times? Have you ever seen it give up, turn away, fail? No. It perseveres and always achieves success. Where is your effort, your superior brain? Even an ant has more faith in itself." To believe that they would understand anything at all was too optimistic. Pick up your spades and clear this mess with your own hands. My voice rose so high that the nation's orphans emerged from their hovels across the green poison. I shouted across the field to them, "Protect yourself and your children as conscious human beings." Though then I had a rush of anger at the state and directed it towards them instead. "You crawl, grovel, weep and beg for somebody else to respect you, slithering in slime, unfit to live. So die slowly, kill your children and doom your generations. I find no valid reason to respect you. You're not worthy of that." They cried and pleaded, promised and committed. Then I accepted. Their change of mind is true. I challenged them. "Then throw away these flies that you're collecting. Will they one day transform into a sanitation plant? Will your children live to exhibit them like helpless beggars, telling tales of woe and sorrow in their own time? Forever and ever." When they swore to take the matter in hand, I cooled towards them and instructed them with methods that would clear the infested swamp. Turning to leave, I wondered whether anything had really been absorbed. But a few months later, I turned to open the ED center and stood smiling for a long time. Last time, the night had reached at its intensity. Today, light had broken through. I observed the concave clearing. Drains ran through it in the midst of fields. Thin patches of grass were sprouting. Women hung clothes on washing lines. Children played. A dog washed his tail, sometimes whisked excitedly and sometimes fell still. Motivation towards corrective social welfare was the answer to hindrances created by individualistic politics and vested interests. They were lobbies in need of beggars as oxygen for power. The nation was captive to inherent and unresolved contradictions. The power relationships had remained exactly the same as colonists towards the native. The maimon states towards the community and husbands towards wives. Keep them in your clutches, never free them, not in mind or body or independence, not in mind or body. Independence will make them think and do, and in their freedom they will discard you and take flight. I cursed and shouted under my breath. Presented new possibilities of extensive social reform. Life was a plan whose seed was sown long ago, was not clear, but I had felt its sensation, so as it coursed through my veins. I returned repeatedly to the first steps I had taken towards it. Now I could comprehend it to the smallest degree, down to the very bottom in my small beginnings. Those little insights at the first dispensary, on the crossroads of Karachi, in the alleys of Mithadar, and in the eyes of the struggling masses, those deprived of identity, respect, direction, support, and hope, most of all, hope. My colleagues had learned not to discourage me. When I instructed them to come for the demarcations of various centers, I knew they were shaking their heads. Not only were they confused at my big plans, they were also aware of my intolerance of slackness and mistakes while conducting work. After covering Sindh and settling my progressive friends in Nawabshah, Larkana, and Hyderabad, I moved to Balochistan. I was immediately warned, if a Baloch Sardar's car passes by, no ambulance carrying a poor slave can dare overtake it. In Quetta, the locals discouraged and frightened me further, and I sensed the usual greed to monopolize charity. They scared me of kidnapping and ambulance thefts. As you neither know the terrain nor the influential DDs I have, you have no choice but to take a local partner, I exclaimed. Is this a foreign country? Soon enough, while carrying a body from Balochistan to Sarkar, our ambulance was stolen. I lodged a complaint with the Sardar, who magnanimously ordered, "These ambulances must be returned by morning, or else a new one will be bought by collecting public toll." It was promptly returned. When a Parsi gentleman donated a house to the foundation, I broke away from local intimidation. People lived in the primitive ages, completely oblivious to the existence of basic amenities. Due to the unavailability of public transport, the ills were carried for miles, either on the shoulders of relatives or on charpoys before they could reach a hospital. Beyond Quetta lay vast stretches of empty spaces, and on the far horizon, craggy mountains drew a high boundary wall. There was utter poverty and no vegetation. Only by straining the eye could one spot an isolated mud shack at a great distance from which stood another. In one such hut, a man murdered his wife, left his two-year-old son with his dead mother, bolted the door behind him and fled. The traumatized child was discovered after 3 days and brought to the ED center in Quetta. Instances of crime were so common in this part of the country that very few days passed without a grotesque incident. The concept of charity was absolutely alien to these people, for which reason I had to create a support system of alternate contributions. I hired teachers, doctors, and students to create social awareness. And although operations began to take the same shape as in other provinces, Balochistan Center was the most difficult to establish. It was the same in the old city of Multan, situated in the Saraiki belt beyond the borders of Sindh. People had rarely did anything without profit and publicity, as it was central to the Punjab, and the majority suffered the same problem as they did all over the country. Much as I wished to, I could not turn away. I sent a trusted colleague to set up the center, and we began the operation. Right. The people of the Saraiki belt were, however, highly respectful. They believed so fervently in saints and peace that they would lift the earth from beneath my feet and put it on their eyes as a form of respect. But they would not keep from their money. There was no spirit of charity. As this attitude directly affected the benefits I envisaged for the poor, I explained to them softly, "What difference does going to another make to mankind? I'm not important in any way other than that I serve the poor. If you follow me, do likewise." Humanitarianism reduces the value of passports and borders. The people of this area constantly wove intrigues to divide the masses. I told my colleagues, "Do you now understand why I've remained alone? Two authorities would have created confusion, indecision, and complication." Addressing students at the Bahadur Zakaria University in Multan, I said, In the rights of mankind, if the rights of mankind are forbidden in our religion, tell me if picking injured and dead people from trains and road accidents, airplane crashes, and building collapses is a sin? Tell me if feeding hungry people lying on footpaths, jungles, deserts, and shrines is a sin? Tell me if providing assistance to the sick, writhing in pain, hopeless, disabled, and mental is forbidden? Tell me and I'll stop working. I will inform the world that we condemn compassion and reject the basic rights of man. I had often heard the people of other provinces abuse central Punjab for various reasons. In my experience, after the Urdu-speaking community, they were the least prejudiced towards the differences of caste, race, and religion. Centers
that had begun to operate under the 25-kilometer program was established on the same lines as the first initiative in Meetup. I cannot overstate the importance of nurturing the initial stage of any project for a better growth. The first phase had begun, the second was taking shape in my mind. Step by step, I was moving forward, drawing up plans for trauma centers at every 100 kilometers and rural awareness centers at every 25 kilometers. Ambulances that were spread across the country were instructed to stop no matter where and pick up any mentally handicapped or destitute person. Those who have no care surpass the line of negligence and must be relieved from that condition immediately. I consider their plight an insult to every citizen of the nation. They were sheltered at local centers and transported to Meetathar, Sorapkot, or Apnaghar for the shelterless. Basic facilities were at this point adequate. Along with the destitute and psychotics from all over Pakistan came various breeds of injured animals. I hired vets to heal them, and small compounds became their temporary abode. Lack of space and the freedom essential for this species made me release them as soon as it was possible. Bilkis recovered an injured cat and decided to set up an animal sanctuary spread over 4 acres of land. I remarked, the government has all the facilities at its disposal, but refrains from taking any beneficial steps. I replied to the provincial government for amenity plots at reduced rates, but there was usually no response to my request. When there was, allotments were cut down from my demands of 16 canals to 6 canals and then to 4. I refused the offer and commented to my friends, I suppose it would be too far-fetched to consider that some clever man had noticed and decided to control our expansion. Monkeys, cats, dogs, squirrels, deer and mongoose inhabited the sanctuaries, and where the mute or the mentally disabled were given the task to care for them, I was not at all surprised to witness the compassion and caring in a people who were otherwise handicapped. On the other hand, those of normal mind left me astounded. If a camel was unwell, they would rather cut it up and eat it than treat it. Inedible animals like dogs, cats, and mules were discarded and left to die slow deaths. A beast of burden was so heavily laden that every single rupee spent on its upkeep was extracted from it. The same extraction as the colonialist took from the native, master from servant and husband from wife. My heart bled whenever I stopped to point to this blatant evidence of human greed and cruelty. I would often stop on the road and say, you flay an animal under its heavy burden, so mercilessly punishing it for slowing its pace or for some inadvertent move of disobedience. The absence of compassion and the rejection of God, our history is replete with cruel leadership, which corroded and weakened the practice of compassionate doctrine and cemented distorted values. I drove the ambulance alongside a horse-driven tonga and observed the old dolls and tin boxes strapped across the animal's ribs. I drove for some distance and watched the animal drag itself, pulling the weight of a carriage full of fat men sitting upon each other. They sat beside the driver, spread across the back seat, one upon another and on the step below, which bent down inches above the road, and they swept their feet on the ground, relishing the joyride. Others clasped their hands across the carriage poles on both sides and hung outward. The animal's knees buckled at every few trots, and its failing strength drew the driver's wrath. He responded with a fit of furious flaying. I shouted the man to stop and halted the ambulance, disembarked, and stood beside the horse. Have you heard of a man called Edi? I asked. He had. I repeated the question to the passengers. All of them turned to stare and replied in the affirmative. I introduced myself. They swiftly came off and forward to bend and clasp my hands between their palms. The ritual over, I inquired, are you Muslims? Of course they were. I informed them, does the example of your journey not make you comprehend that you are not? I softly asked the driver to unburden the load from the horse and give the passengers a sermon. Have you no sense of degree? Your practice spreads doom on the nation. Men like you pronounce, expound and disseminate the war of injustice amongst the lowest rung of society. You pull it out from the houses of power into your impoverished streets, poverty-stricken, hopeless beggars lashing out against those more helpless than themselves. The example you have set for rulers to adopt against you in your undoing, what a betrayal. Across the world, and I was in the midst of it. It had become imperative that those who worked with me believed in my vision I preached to them. The original opponents of our faith remain entrenched in power. Voices have been raised against them for centuries, but nobody has succeeded in crushing their rule. Faces, names, incentives, and methods changed. Each clung on
to its humane banner, but warped its principles. They propagated self-serving brands of religion based on humanitarianism. Not having read history, I did not present myself as a scholar, but I had no doubt of either my knowledge or, in many respects, the lack of it. I summed it up. The degree of commitment required to retrieve the truth from the clutches of usurpers is clearly specified in the story of Karbala, and the truth of all religions is humanitarianism. While marking spots for future centers and organizing those we were already operating, I observed everything on the way. I was all the more aware now that the neglected Third World was in dire need of a welfare revolution. This guy is just like me. A philosophy that could filter into the hearts of people and pull them away from self-destruction. The demand for this change cannot end, nor can its gravity lessen, nor can this manner of existence remain forever. Dawn must break. My mind confirms this and reinforces my commitment to its accomplishment. Like the persistent ant, we do not need EP, I proclaim to the few colleagues and workers on the site. We require a system like the West, a system that creates people like him, that which commits men to the oath of office and the rule of morality. This became clearer as thoughts of my own mortality surfaced, and I began to work quietly on the subject. Although on the one hand I suffered from impatience, I could still foresee another 30 years before I could present a basic but solid setting ground for a model welfare state. It had required unlimited patience. God willing, from here will spread the ideal system for the Third World, one that will benefit people of poor nations at maximum benefit and minimal expense. From its study will arise many answers to questions that established welfare states should adopt onto their own system, and we will catch a glimpse of world unity, one God, one system. Where is the conflict? For this great purpose, I was in no rush. Life permitting, I knew it was achievable. My life not permitting, it was no longer my business. Just as he had sown in me seeds of humanitarianism, others would appear to plow and harvest the field. 240 ED centers were operating through 8 administrative units: Karachi, Sakhar, Hyderabad, Mumbai, Khas, Faisalabad, Multan, Karachi, Multan, Islamabad, and Quetta. Meerutsagar was the nerve center. All cities and ambulances were linked to it by VHF and HFA stations, enabling me to exercise control across the country. My methods remained unconventional but practical. In a remote area of Balochistan, where the need for a center was urgent, I provided a volunteer with a wireless and connected him to the nearest ambulance point. After initiation of a center, I made prompt efforts to regularize my work with concerned authorities. Each zone was headed by a zonal manager who oversaw the management of all the booths and centers spread across within his area. At the end of each month, accounts, summary reports, and expense vouchers for welfare activities were forwarded from the zonal chief to headquarters. These were examined for rates shown on items purchased, and payments were made by checks issued personally by me. Disbursements to respective centers within the zones were made by zonal chiefs, and we were able to develop a relatively good pattern at per capita expense. At the year end, all accounts were audited. Keeping in mind the expediency required for efficient delivery of checks, circulars, and documents, facilities up to district level were acquired on a gratis basis from a private courier service. PIA delivered 250 kilograms of postage free of cost every month. The most meager donations were accepted by issuing our trademark receipt, one retained in the local record, another forwarded by the zonal office to headquarters, and the third with a stamped envelope was handed over to the donor for postage to Meerutsagar. Fear had become an excellent deterrent against corruption. 95% of all receipts were now received at headquarters. Donations ranging from 5 rupees to many hundreds of thousands were deposited into the foundation's local bank accounts and spent on the uplift of the area from where the money generated. When the people of Faisalabad donated 3 ambulances, they benefited themselves. Weak centers were given grants from rich zones. Contributions made in kind were stored in warehouses, and delivery of provisions to all centers was made from these points. The number of staff had risen to 1,000 people, but less than 10% of the total expenditure was towards administration. Zonal managers, accountants, clerks, nurses, midwives, and ambulance drivers were mostly employed on an allowance. Purely voluntary services, full or part-time, took many forms. Several organizations contributed medical supplies and technical know-how, architectural, engineering, medical, legal, and financial services. Doctors and other professionals served us by allocating whatever time they could spare. Many physicians and surgeons cooperated from private clinics. People from various professions and different classes were recruited for emergency service, but most volunteers were from the lower middle class. My focus remained on public motivation, whereby the poor as well as the rich became shareholders in national welfare industry. As an emergency service demanded 24 hours of duty, conscientious drivers were required. They were kept under strict surveillance and observed for at least 15 days before final approval. Though Velvet talked work with me, he usually deposited at the counter after each trip and handed back to drivers at the time of the next appointment.
Timings of departure and return were accurately noted to the office register. When misuse of a vehicle or of petrol theft was detected, the man responsible was dismissed without a second chance. All drivers were trained in first aid and in the handling of accident victims. Driving the ambulance, I often thought of how it had all begun and recalled how fast I used to run in Bantwa. The precision with which I would decrease my speed before a sharp turn or slide around a semicircular bend, my body tilting to one side like a glider, was maintained in the ambulance. The rickety poor man's van had been replaced by the fleet of 500 ambulances speeding all over the country, reaching out to its furthermost corner, declaring Edi as a poor man's friend. Soha, announcing a service without discrimination, without blaring out empty slogans, ambulances were our most effective advertisements. My quest for creating awareness towards social welfare had made the name Edi a signpost, but as much as the presence of the fleet raised consciousness towards my work, its relevance still remained undetected. One day, the ideology behind it would be studied. Today, its presence everywhere announced to the 12 crore population that had not been abandoned. I was working for them all the time, patiently. PIA did not accept coffin boxes, and we had faced many problems in long-distance transportation. Flying in a rented aircraft to transport the body of an assassinated sub-inspector of police to Faisalabad, I mentioned to my colleagues, we need an air ambulance service, don't you think? We were soon preparing a feasibility through a group of professional technicians, and within a week, a core technical crew was inducted into the organization. A Piper aircraft was purchased in 1988. Mr. Robert Oakley, the U.S. ambassador, presented us a helicopter. Through USAID, we accepted only because it had no conditions attached. By the year 1988, we had established the largest burial service for unclaimed bodies. The metropolitan corporations of all big cities in Pakistan had made annual contracts with us for burial of unidentified victims of drowning, homicide, and accidents. Free coffins and coffin boxes were provided to those who could not pay. With assistance of the church or the local temple, non-Muslims were provided services according to their own beliefs. When the extremist element continued to condemn me for burying non-Muslims, I snapped. Next time a child falls off a roof, I shall refuse to transport it to a hospital without a certificate confirming his religion. At the funeral of a highly enlightened Christian who died homeless, I commented, his tombstone marks an open grave. His epitaph should say, he who died without a motherland. In 1989, the Chief Minister of the Punjab, Mian Nawaz Sharif, invited me to breakfast. I politely declined his offer to have me collected and, accompanied by a colleague, arrived at his office in my ambulance. He listened attentively while I talked of the necessity of moving Pakistan towards becoming a social welfare state. I recognized his business mind every time I raised a feasible proposal, and yet he missed the point, the fact that welfare was the only political option. Economic stability were all encompassed in the collective concept of social welfare. It would initiate trust and keep a bloody revolution at bay. I pointed out flaws in the Western concept of dole, declaring it as the root cause of laziness. Termites feeding on the inadequate welfare funds of empty exchequers. National survival, unity, and economic stability were all encompassed in the collective concept of social welfare. It would initiate trust and keep a bloody revolution at bay. I pointed out flaws in the Western concept of dole, declaring it as a root cause of laziness, termites feeding on the inadequate welfare funds of empty exchequers. I stressed the use of available labor to combat unemployment and dole. More banks should open and new job allocations should be introduced in two shifts. All factories, banks, telephones, and most departments should be run in 2 to 4 shifts. It will end the excuse of running away under the pretext of meals. I told him that Bhutto was correct when he introduced temporary jobs. One shift on salary basis was not beneficial for a developing nation. Finally, I came down to possibilities and suggested, as health services are imperative, mobile dispensaries with qualified doctors are economically more feasible than stationary 5-story buildings housing hospitals. The chief minister liked the idea and offered, give me any man you choose, Edi Sahib, and I will appoint him at secretary level. Funds will be put at his disposal for any project you wish to promote, and I promise there will be no interference. I declined the partnership. He clasped my hand between both his at the door and said, when I come into power, Edi Sahib, I will adopt your advice. A welfare state is truly the only course to take, but self-preservation is known to rule supreme, and ideas and concepts change with power. My friend, if politicians had the potential to practice what I advise, they would have achieved much by now. I drove out into the freedom of the street, sure that unless they solved people's problems, they would merely be coming and going. A news item confirmed a meningitis epidemic in Hyderabad, and a team was dispatched with vaccines. At the Nawab Shah Center, they were confronted by thousands of people. When the crowds grew beyond their capacity, my colleagues panicked on the phone. on the telephone. 5,000 vaccines are not enough. Send more urgently. The public is coming at us from everywhere. 3 million vaccines were ordered from France in emergency. Nurses prepared them in Meetadhar, packed them in chilled boxes, and we dispatched them through PIA to Dadu, Larkana, Shikarpur, and Nawabshah. By then, people had collected like a mob at a public rally. From a far off road between the fields, more were coming, like a hot river flowing down under the scorching sun. Announcements and loudspeakers tried to maintain order while 30 volunteers injected separate sections. Many fights ensued. We vaccinated 1 million people across Sindh. I thought the government would come forward. But as always, they were satisfied with the responsibility lying on my shoulders. I'm sure they blissfully commented on one another. "Ed is doing a good job, good man." While we spent millions on controlling the epidemic, over 250 people died and our volunteers became confident in being able to control large-scale calamities. In 1989, I was awarded in the Shan Imtiaz. This time, also, I did not want to attend the ceremony, but realized beforehand that Bilkis was an influence that more than often affected and changed my decision. First, she was happy. "Your country has noticed that you love it." When she saw me disinterested, she became serious. "Why should you refuse recognition of your work? The organization does not receive anything else from the government." So off I went to Islamabad. Bilkis's word trailed behind even as I left. 10 awards are little for you. The foundation is the only nationwide public service. 5 years of no rain in the desert of Thar had made it a permanent calamity area for us. When a severe famine resulted, I made a personal visit. Many people had migrated to Mibrufas and I was disgusted with the decadence of those who remained behind. I asked them, "How does the national attitude of sacrifice not stir in you at a time of adversity? Why do you not fight it off even when you most need it?" They were prepared to spend on luxury items available despite the catastrophe. They purchased foreign cigarettes, beeries, tobacco, and tea all day while their family starved. I stayed for 1 week, set up 35 camps, stocked them with rations, gave 1,000 sermons, and left. Kubra was expecting a second child when she returned to Pakistan with Kashif. Her dilemma had increased. She was not just unable to adjust because poverty without work is stark. She could not come to terms with complacency and apathy, with the lack of ambition and perseverance that had created my status. I demanded to know from Bilkis, what is Kubra's status? Has she inherited it from me? I told my wife to inform all my children. They cannot become shareholders in my labor. This is a profession of the heart. Those of them who wish to inherit shall have to follow it as a way of life. It is not a kingdom. It is a mission. I was distraught and paced up and down the Meetadhar offices. I understood that my daughter wanted her husband to measure up to me. I agreed that Altaf did not have extraordinary ambitions, but I questioned Bilkis. What is her ambition? If she has it, she should instill that in him. If she's searching for me, she will find me in a hungry stomach, in a broken heart, an empty pocket, and at the doorstep of a shack. That I grieved was not because I could not face the breakup of my daughter's marriage for conservative reasons. Divorce is perfectly justified. If two parties are unable to achieve compatibility, it is a voluntary social contract and can be annulled easily at any time. For me, Kubra's future pain was obvious. My interaction with her was limited, and she never talked about the subject to anyone. I remained worried as the matter loomed like a black cloud over me, and I could not stop questioning. How ironic that my child is torn despite no contradiction in our life. How powerful are those external influences that did not let her observe me when I was right there? How long more will they take to recede, and what will it take for my daughter to be free? Kubra avoided me so well that I did not have to avoid her. Through all this ethnic and linguistic violence continued to erupt at short intervals, and new allegations aimed at affecting and diverting funds away from us. The foundation was alleged to be leading export industry of soft organs and human bones to foreign countries, that also without documented permission. If somebody called for us to collect animal hides or needed for the ambulance service, young boys armed with Kalashnikovs blocked the way into the busties, threatening our drivers and made them reverse the vans. The benefit leaders procured from these bullying tactics bought them more weapons, but adversely affected the deprived when I suffered a squeeze in donations. When ambulances were hijacked from Korangi and Lanti, I spoke of the problem to the press, but rejected a suggestion that I call on various leaders for help. Although I was an eccentric man, I was also a very practical one and told reporters, what business can I have with them? The incidents are as much in their knowledge as they are in mine. If they condone them and I do not, there can be no discussion. In answer to warnings against my loose talk, I said to a journalist, I have no bias against any color, breed, class or religion. I am an immigrant myself. Let me work. Do not ache me down along with everything else. I've been surviving and building despite the increasing disparity and disorder in all things. But opposition was a common factor that chased after those who aimed at higher purposes. Why does it become common a long time ago? Now it took root as the value of law plummeted. Lawyers could not produce witnesses, and so the case could neither commence nor conclude. There was no way to catch the assailants. Instructions came from the top. This is our case, and this is no, and there is no witness. There was no choice but to grant bail. Soon enough, the witnesses would be gunned down or disappear from the face of the earth. I would suggest to every judge I met, no sooner is a big criminal arrested, he's free again. At least detain them for a few days so that the locality gets some respite. Many parents whose son became involved in these criminal activities would plead in desperation, kill our children, Edi Sahib. They have become ruthless murderers. Sometimes when a man with criminal support outside got out of police control, he was shot and was termed a police mukabla. Sometimes the court lengthened the case and it remained stuck for years. Even the West suffered from unnecessarily long court cases, and they too would have to make reforms. When the hide and skin business was usurped by political purposes, I was angry. They used to throw away the skins or give them to the butcher. Now I made 14,000 rupees from them. When I made 14,000 rupees from them, the business became profitable and other groups tried to snatch it away, but they were only able to chip away at it. After we achieved an awareness that made possible the collection of 35,000 hides in each city, linguistic groups flew in. Everywhere I turned, there stood an obstacle, religious and linguistic groups, social workers and agents. We were all threatening people with boycotts. They were fighting for a good source of income. I was fighting for delivery. 44 years of service were shaken by false propaganda. Warnings of the destruction of my mission rose to the forefront of my mind, and no amount of work or preoccupation put suspicion to rest. This condition made me shout at everyone about things unrelated to them. I cursed the government's inadequacy at the maternity unit while women ran around in a confused state of panic. On the telephone, a Sawali would call for a favor, and I would give him hell about the situation we were facing. On the roadside, I complained to taxi drivers, rickshaw drivers, and pedestrians, and of course, all my colleagues had to suffer with me. Sometimes I turned the matter into a joke. They make such a noise about Islam. Telling us it's coming, but it's always an air-conditioned Islam that remains under lock and key in their quarters. I shut the Mithadar office in protest and sat in Sohrab court. Everyone who came to appease me and convince me to return to Mithadar heard my tirade against the situation. I threatened. I roam your streets and I'm sick and tired of making a workable system for you. I'll leave you. I'll go to Jerusalem, Srinagar or Calcutta. I'll tell the world that Muslims refuse to help. They are people who only seek the rich, the poor and the destitute. Everyone needs charity in any guise. If a politician came by, I would have a field day. You feel no compassion for the poor, yet you feel no shame in begging for foreign aid in their name. I am tired of fulfilling your responsibilities. Sometimes I would clamp up and send everyone away. But did not disturb anyone. I would scream louder. They don't give a damn if I go or stay. They will leave me to stand on the road. 2,000 people will pass by. One will give, the rest will jeer at me. Only when somebody is crushed in an accident, he will say, there is no one like Edi. His hands will lift in prayer for me. He will flatter me, but give no money for the 10,000 destitute lying with me. At these times, when anybody referred to my good work for God, I would say sarcastically, I don't work for returns. I don't like a selfishly procured heaven. I'd rather go to hell. Cute man, sweet man. The players for my return to Mithadar went on and on while I shouted all the while. 1% has a freehold lease of the country. By it, they change their own fate. Every department, every sector and every assembly is full of imperialists. 12 crore peoples are under the grip of a mafia. When aid comes, they quickly make a committee to disperse it into their pockets. That's what I say in the Gadha Party, gadhaparty.com. Went on and on. And then back at Mithadar, late one night, I was sitting on the bench with a supporter and two men arrived on a scooter. Edi Sahib, a man has just died of heart failure. His family has no money for his burial. Please help them. I took a coffin, jumped into the ambulance along with my friend and one of the two men while the other led the way. We soon lost our guide and his companion directed us from one area to another until I realized we were driving around in circles. Finally, he asked us to stop at a dhobi ghat and went off. We waited beside the van until I saw them both emerge together at a distance. Instinctively, I became suspicious and told my companion, when they get close, I'll pretend to hug one of them and beat him while you catch the other. He was visibly shocked at my program. They approached. I switched on the headlight and swift as lightning leapt on one, twisted his arm tightly behind him and a knife fell. Struggling with the other man, my friend saw the knife and screamed, Bachao, bachao, they'll kill Edi. Truck drivers, taxi drivers and passengers rushed from the nearby stand and beat up the two men. Holding them, they suggested that we notify the police station and register a case. But there was no need for that. And so I said, release them and let us watch them flee like scared foxes instead.
At home, Bilkis was worried. Who do you think sent them? They might come again. I had too many matters of priority to become involved in a police hassle, and said difficulties always come to obstruct good work. As there is no time to wait, it is better waste. It is better to move aside and step away from enemies. Forget who sent them. We have no way of knowing that. Senses of survival, and I began to search for better safeguards. Now I was on my mark like a tiger, alert to the slightest unexpected new information. To work with me under these circumstances needed 101% tolerance, and when it was not so, you can go, was my theory. As the best safeguard was the organization within, I explained at a meeting, if I suffer from a terminal illness, if I die, I will die from it anyway. What fear then of an ambush? My colleagues would say amongst themselves, every few months he finds a reason to shout, shake us up and give us a shock. We are all affected, he calms down again. By now, they knew me well and did not mind my outburst. In fact, it was said, Edie began to smile and laugh in 1985. Before that, he was always angry. On hearing this, I laughed. I wish I could have found my birth certificate instead of the date of my good cheer. Character assessment was the asset by which I had built a solid base. Years of observing human nature and an inherent attraction to truth had enabled the creation of a clean system amongst corrupt surroundings. The movement ran on this advantage. It now helped me to protect it. When a man entered my office, his posture revealed hidden traits. He spoke and intentions emerged from his tone of voice and manner of speech. I told my colleagues, how does one mango at the bottom of the basket avoid rotting when all those around it and above it are rotten? Thousands and thousands of people suffered from environmental infection. Always begging for charity, they came in hordes. A healthy woman in a burqa would come and sit down coyly, as if she stepped out of her four walls for the first time. I'm a widow with six children who are hungry, they will die. I would say impatiently, fill an application for a sewing machine. The woman would disappear. Another would replace her, crying, my mother died this morning, I have no money for her coffin or the journey home. I would shout out for somebody, take her, fill an application, provide the coffin and transport the body to the village. Woman would disappear. A sheepish youth would sneak in. Please give me money for my sister's burial. I am the sole earning member of a family of 10. They're all dying. I would offer, we will bury her. Go in the ambulance and bring her to us. Bring all your family as well. Admit them in apna ghar. He would shy away. Tears flowing down, sunken cheeks. Another pleaded, Edi Sahib, my child is ill in the village. There's no money for medicines or transport. Please help me. I would shout out, prepare the ambulance, write the address and take this man's ID card. The man would flee. A healthy young youth would whine. I have no job, no place to live, no money to feed my family, and my father has left me heavy debts to pay. He would sob loudly. I would quieten him and advise, work here with me. Every evening you will earn 100 rupees. Feed your family with it. Then think of debts. He would vanish. A man with a cigarette in his mouth would saunter in to collect sacrificial meat. I would shoo him away. Many took allowances from their unions but came for free meat to us pleading. Our children haven't eaten for 3 days. I would send them scampering out, exclaiming, then they must be dead. It was a nation that exaggerated everything. Hundreds and hundreds of lazy people related gruesome tales and left addresses of homes that did not exist. To some, I would snap, tell me, why do you feel you deserve easy cash? What stops you from labor, from your responsibility to yourself? You gamble and take heroin. I can see it in your eyes. You're not poor, but lazy and fraudulent. The negative offspring of a bad giving you cash or kind is poisonous. Work is the only charity I can offer. Clean the gutter outside and I'll pay you. Many heard these words and fled. Despite the shortage of domestic help, women were kept on allowances rather than put to sympathetic through systematic work. I had often suggested, convert unemployed women from your communities into domestic servants. That way they will neither steal nor live on charity and will make a decent living. I had told many charitable organizations, the best way to give a sewing machine is through a loan. Habitual people apply in different names and take away 8 machines to sell. Economic loopholes had established an ideology of organized corruption in society, spreading poverty and disorder in society. Habitual reliance and sloganeering had caused a moral breakdown. God willing, my system would use another way. I would tell a genuine man in need, when I'm ready to present my system, a new ideology will spread. Maybe something else will be born from my work. Some changes will be made, but it will end the monopoly. Man is fundamentally free only when he raises his willpower. Although you feel hopeless today, tomorrow will be better. An old man walked to my office and sat down. He was looking for a 16-year-old girl to marry. I refused. Go to your community and ask them to give you one of theirs. He said he wanted to marry a shelterless girl. I asked, is that because a young girl with a roof will not take you? If the destitute could find husbands on the streets, what a better world it would be. Always they were lying. Some march in to complain. There is too much corruption in your service. I knew that. Despite my attention to the foundation's construction sites, people took cuts and commissions at 11 levels, and most were trackless. But these allegations were dramas. Those who were quick to criticize were three times cleverer than the thief. One out of three persons was corrupt. Crookery had become our second nature. I would calm the complainant. I could have been a big capitalist, a tax steward, a tyrannical leader, but instead I opened a big shop. Our moral standing has fallen because of no welfare. I'm practical like the administration. The government is practical by procuring tax. Social work is practical by public contributions. Both can function effectively only if the direction is correct. Because of my easy accessibility, many people thronged to meet other for favors. As I was known to everybody, they thought I could help through my contacts. But I did not believe in individual help, and I always turned them away. This is the business of peers, mashaiks, politicians, businessmen, and prominent social workers. They are a channel of introduction for one another and do each other's work. Some would persist despite these views. E.D. Saib, you know, so and so, it's small work. One telephone call from you will help my family. I would snap back. It's not my subject. I cannot get involved in this circle. I also heard much praise and flattery offering to gold me. E.D. Saheb, we are organizing immense support for you in our community. They are creating voters for me, arranging functions, seminars and award ceremonies. Then they begged people to attend, but their bad reputation in their area enticed only a few at the function. One stooge had instructions to clap, 15 followed, raising slogans. It was a way towards purchasing personal fame. There was nothing to the hollow men except a hunger to see their photograph in the print media. The nation had bred in this environment. People had become adept at creeping up on politicians and reminding them of debts. I organized a rally for you, sir. It cost me so much money. And the cement plant, a permit, and plot became deserved. There were no favors from me, only heartache, only one heartache. Everybody wanted the best. I would say, come to my hospital and I'll send you to Jinnah. But they wanted to go abroad for treatment. I would send them out. People were the arms and legs of politicians, trained to combat the law. They had found all the possible loopholes, those that I had closed in my system. The country, in fact, ran on the rules I had rejected. I would shake my head at the mess and say, when a shirt is full of holes, you cannot mend it. You must change it. During interviews for employment, I could foretell those who would run away from the pressure of my vigilance. My instincts were usually accurate, but collective work was necessary for motivation to spread. I could not get 100% result. I could not get 100% results, for which reason I made some compromises. There was, however, no compromise with laziness and corruption. If I found these flaws inherent in anybody, I was ruthless and without hesitation showed them him the door. Most workers volunteered because they were inspired by my personal example and followed it as best as they could. I recruited my staff from the majority from those with my qualifications, those who sincerely believed in my purpose. They will naturally follow me into a world where there is no high and low. Correct outcomes are achieved by the victory of simplifying complicated matter. By 1990, we had employed 2,000 full-time volunteers. It was an army of committed and motivated men and women who were willing to spread the doctrine of social welfare by sheer examples. Without them, my work would not have been possible. Although the network expanded and spread across the country, I did not believe in expanding our core administration and continued to rely on the inmates, thereby encouraging self-help as well as curtailing expenses. By this method, only a small staff was required for an estimated 10,000 persons residing in our home. By promoting self-respect instead of charity, people looking for shelter became part of the establishment and an improved quality of life. Enriched attitudes, greater awareness, a sense of movement and accomplishment were some of the benefits achieved. The inmates simultaneously acquired basic skills in construction, painting, mechanical and electrical work, nursing, cooking and monitoring. Faisal completed his 11th grade in Orlando, felt homesick and returned to Pakistan for the U.S. My friends advised me to enroll him in the Habib Public School, explaining his English is good and he has acquired the higher academic standard schools of Pita that can provide Maulana. Although I no longer asked them not to refer to me as Maulana, it still irritated me. I asked them to do what they thought best, but made it clear that I was not in a position to request anybody for a favor. A few days later, they returned with Faisal in tow and grinned sheepishly. Faisal passed the entry exam, but they wanted a donation of 5,000 rupees before they admitted Maulana. They knew my answer. I gave it anyway. I refused to pay. If Faisal wants to study, let him improve the standard of a cheaper school. When Bilkis heard, she deposited her own money. When I heard, I protested at the waste, but she ignored me. Kubra's second son was born, and I named him Bilal.
Bilqis and I took to him immediately, and so the little bundle became a permanent sight at the Mithadhar office. Around the same time, a young man humbly entered the Mithadhar office and introduced himself as Javed, the 10-year-old child I had pulled out from under the collapsed structure of Bismillah building. Bilqis came in, and we recalled the two orphan brothers. Javed worked as a bank clerk and had come with a proposal of marriage for Almas. Almas had never caused us any problems. A content and patient child, she kept very much to the home, cooking, cleaning, and looking after her sister's children. She had just taken her matriculation exam, and Bilqis suggested to Javed that he first see her, but he declined politely. I have accepted her anyway. We withheld the answer until Rabia Ma returned from her fifth Hajj. When she agreed, everybody else conceded, and it became a time for jokes and laughter. Khala asked me in amazement, "Did you know you were saving your son-in-law?" Rabia Ma proclaimed, "Fate protected him for your daughter." How sweet of the boy to remember. Each and every person Mithadhar had something to say about the issue. Then the dhulki arrived again, and wedding songs made the dream real. I had to leave for England and was due to return on the morning before Almas' departure from home. It became a catastrophe when Bilqis informed that I had missed the flight back. She was so furious that she shouted into the receiver at my colleagues, "You can all go to hell, all of you together." When he told me, I was petrified and quickly called her to explain, but she would not listen. "You must have done this intentionally. I refuse to believe you could miss anything you wish to catch," I defended myself. Why should I not want?
I have other important things waiting for my attention as well. I really did miss the flight. It was to no avail. Bilqis was sure that I had once again avoided a person's responsibility. She gave her judgment. "As we all know, you too well, nobody's prepared to believe your story. Click." Almas was embarrassed, as Qutb was also, and couldn't take my place. When somebody commented, "Edie does not even care to attend his daughter's marriage," she cried and worried that her in-laws might taunt her. But they were kind people. Bilqis made her usual excuse for my absence. "Please don't mind that Edie didn't come. He's not a hard man. Please don't mind. His work has always consumed him. He didn't come to my wedding either. Please don't mind." When I returned, Almas had left. But now my wife began to pester me to attend the bridegroom's walima. I refused to accompany her. "I do not believe in this sort of expenditure. Bilqis, how can I go?" She argued and nagged me. "The expenditure is not your problem. It's not your money. The boy's family is spending it. It's their expense, not ours." I stuck to my view, but I'm against the principle. I would rather that the system was abolished. Finally, a few days later, I went to visit Almas and Javed at their home. Javed, I had a friend, a Javi friend, and he had somebody who was working for him. His name was Javed. And there had another guy who was from Faisalabad. Javed was from, I think, Kushnawada or Sialkot. So the guy from Faisalabad, every morning he would call Javed in a characteristic way. He would say, "Javed!" It was amazing. Very different. Anyway. After only 1 month, Faisal announced that he found the studies too burdensome. They emphasized memorizing without any understanding and give marks on the length of an answer rather than precise content. Bilqis looked so worried that I might scream about the financial loss that I refrained from mentioning it at all. When Faisal returned to the US to join Qutb in New York, I was relieved. About 2 furlongs away from Sanghi Railway Station, Zakaria Express, the Karachi bound passenger train from Multan, charged at full speed and collided with a goods train parked on the same track. The engines, as well as 11 of the 14 compartments of Zakaria Express, were completely crushed, along with 5 compartments of the goods train. Due to the delay of 2 other popular trains at Multan Railway Station, a large number of elevated passengers had boarded the death trap. I remained at the site for 3 days and until the very end, single-mindedly organized relief work. I ignored the usual rumors and speculations that floated amid screams and wails of grieving mothers, new orphans and old people. 350 passengers died and many were maimed for life. The injured were removed to congested hospitals, then into schools and mosques. 26 seriously injured were flown in the ED Air Ambulance Service to Karachi for specialized treatment. During all this, rumors remained high on the list of media as well as the public interest. Sabotage and conspiracy theories circulated as the opposition's propaganda and the government's acquisition aimed to outdo one another. For me, the cause of the accident was simple negligence. Around the same time, a gentleman by the name of Mia Munshi offered that I take over a big hospital he had constructed in the Punjab. I declined politely. I'm moving step by step. Give it to the government so that it can function. There's no possibility of its operations free of cost privately. For that, you need a very strong system. Although he followed my advice, his son came to complain and disagree with the decision. I assured him, After the death of a founder, charity hospitals are taken over by servants who make corrupt unions, break the working speed of the staff, and stir rebellions. Charity is diverted to employees, medicines for the poor are taken away and sold by nurses and interns. Only the dedication of a lifetime can run a hospital. No drama can work. When he understood, I promised to inspect the hospital on my next visit. We had become active at the grassroots level and were also offering unconventional welfare services, like filling forms for the illiterate and providing food and shelter for the wayfarer. This is really the business of mosques, I would complain. They padlock them between prayers and they remain shut like government offices through the night. That was not their original purpose. I had a foreign correspondent. I'm a small man. I told a foreign correspondent, I'm a small man, but God willing, 2 or 3 decades from now, the third world will adopt the system that I'm establishing here. I inquired from him, is there another example of a Muslim organization that equals ours? There was none, except for sycophancy and brokerage, wasteful debates, daydreams, limited ideas, and propaganda. Our leaders had not taken one step towards the people. Yet love for mankind is the essence of Islam. Life, prayer, and fear of the hereafter must essentially contribute towards the present, towards humanitarianism. I told many people who came to me for advice, the basic idea of all religion is a welfare system. If the world were to understand that, religious practice would become popular again. We remain progressively involved in myths, personal promotion, illiteracy, and a lack of values, attitudes more visible in third world countries than anywhere in Europe. I would talk about the matter to every foreigner who came to visit me. The human charter that you have implemented is Islamic and it is not practiced in Pakistan. Do not judge Islam by what you see here. Aspa was not my aim. It was not an aim, so also it was not a need. Crowds and rowdy rallies, wars and weapons, looting, plundering, and killing were not on my agenda. I explained. Authority and repression can neither ensure nor equal the course of a nation. Speedy and tyrannical actions that accompany power are mistakes that chip at it. A system that takes 25 to 30 years of practical work before it stabilizes. When personal matters beckon, who can work so long and on what principle? The structure crumbles and a revolutionary personality ultimately presides over nothing. All that is left are weak words scattered like dreams the morning after. Nothing can be grasped. Nothing comes in hand. Talking about the present system always made me angry. Which parliamentary system has any idea about the constitution? Who knows or speaks of a system? Who is patient or selfless enough to think long term? One group is shoved out and another struts in to take charge of the bank keys. Nor did I tire from telling dynastic ministers. Generation of termites breed over a garbage dump. When the rot collapses, you will fly abroad. These matters sometimes so enraged me that I could not withhold my thought. At other times, I brushed them aside as detrimental to my work at Caledon. In search of state orphans, I would lose my temper and point out disorders to everyone that could hear. I'm giving you results without spilling blood, without high-powered slogans, without an agitation. The rich are safe in my system and the poor are better off. My war is peaceful. It is based on inspirational methods, perseverance, and compassion. It was indeed a civilized war of the 21st century where weapons could do nothing but blow us all to hell. But yes, it was a war. By road or in an airplane, I no longer kept silent. Having overcome the shyness to speak, I lost no opportunity to talk. Neither did exhaustion quieten me. I found it worthwhile, even if a man kept my words to himself or repeated them to thousands. To a flight crew at the airport, I said, the time for thinking people to realize the change I propound has come, not by grand speeches and sermons, but by the example of practical work. When the word Eidhi conveys a message of humanitarianism, we will be on our way towards establishment of a welfare state. Eidhi was in fact a true slogan. It was credible, it summoned up feelings for charity, preached equality and discrimination, reminded us of duty and encouraged trust, love, compassion, initiative. More than that, it made us conscious of mankind rather than the self. With these ideas, many of my friends could not understand my emphasis on the rejection of political leadership for myself. I was, after all, emphasizing my own name, demanding, give me your trust. Judge me by face value, for it's my true value. Watch me, and you'll be compelled to follow me. It was a confusion for many. I would often be clarifying, who else could I ensure as Amin but myself? I'm not in a position to guarantee anyone else. I hoodwink nobody, not in God's name, nor in the unimplementable policies of party manifestos. I do not even extend my hand in the name of the foundation. Only my person bows in humility and only he is guaranteed. I advise many people, if you believe in my intention, before sharing, become shareholders in my business. But if you stay away, I will still provide you with essential services. It is my duty and your right. Life moves one way, I told a man contemplating suicide to avenge social injustice. Just as words do not move back, so also the flow of life only moves forward. Untimely death is a magnified fear of nothing. Whereas resilience is a root, forgiveness is focus, and life is your only capital. You can squander it away or invest it well. Heads of communities were talking of social welfare. Even some learned Islamic leaders were espousing the theory of religion not being confined to mosques and Allahu. They were talking of uplift, beginning with the way of life. Articles appeared in newspapers that made me feel closer to my goal. I told Bilkis to read one. When she finished, she asked, "Did you tell him to write it? It sounds like you." I was very happy. "No, Bilkis, I have nothing to do with it. The winds are moving in the direction of truth." As more people from all walks of life spoke against the big web of deceit, I understood that hearing that nearing a goal actually means nearing death. I had given a solution to most leaders: awaken the nation to its reality and the worst problems that confront it can be resolved. This, however, also destroys power blocks and structures non-beneficial to mass interest. This is why a strong denial of awareness prevails. The comparatively high ratio of awareness in the West was evident from its public response. I explained, a man sees an open manhole or a ditch on the road and reacts independently by writing it to relevant quarters, expressing concern for humanity over himself. Our people neither observe nor respond to anything that is not directly their own concern. They justify their inertia. What good will it do? Who will listen? Nobody is bothered. We will only waste time. My own response was, one day they will realize that you know and see. Then they will also know and see. An enslaved society needs many decades before it is aroused by freedom. I recall the time we were called to remove a dead cow from a locality. The residents had refused to extend help, and I had shouted, "You cannot suffer the smell. You fear infection, but you will not move a finger towards accomplishing your need." "I also do not want to move a finger. The animal should disappear by itself. Make out an application to the government and wait. The cow is not my father or mother either. Why did you call me?" Then when I sat in the ambulance, they rushed forward. Bilkis and I were invited to our first television program. Upon entering the hall, we received a standing ovation from the audience, who continued to clap until we climbed onto the raised platform and sat down to face them. We had not been conscious of the extent of appreciation before this. My wife whispered, "Did you know people loved you so much?" I did not need to think before answering her. "I guess they have few whom they can trust with their love." When the host asked Bilkis to throw some light on me, she laughed confidently. "What light can I throw on a light?" When they asked her about marriage, she said, "It is a gamble. Some win and some lose." Looking at me, she smiled. "I think we have both won." Almas had a son and was well adjusted to an ordinary life with Javed. Occasionally, she left her child at Rabia Ma's house to go out with Javed to a Chinese restaurant. Altaf retired from the U.S. to explain his position. Returned from the U.S. to explain his position. There was no need. I understood it well. I asked Kubra to allow their eldest son Kashif to be with his father. Bilal was 2 years old, and it was decided that he remained with his mother. Most girls, after managing their own homes, find it difficult to return to parental protection, and so it was an unsettling period for Kubra. Our way of life sometimes made her vacillate. She then thought life with her husband was easier, and the confusion only made adjustment difficult in both places. While Kubra spent her time crying, Bilal remained with Bilkis and me. My wife said, "Kubra is so torn and confused, she might become a psychological patient." I did not think so, but conceded, "If my life has made her that, so be it." With that ends chapter number 9. So we'll move to chapter number 10 soon. And I'm happy to say that we've covered 258 pages of the 367. So it's only 100 pages more to go. Fabulous. Well done.